Sylvia Sparza for the petitioner, Mr. Mejia Fuentes. Judge, the record compels the conclusion that the
counsel,
agency...
Counsel, could you try to speak up a little, please?
Yes, thank you.
Or closer to the microphone.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you, Judge. The record compels the conclusion that the agency over-relied on Mr. Mejia Fuentes' adverse determination to dismiss his CAT claim. Nowhere does the IJ or the BIA decision address Mr. Mejia's CAT claim under the correct standard. They only address his negative credibility, then conclude that he has not met his burden of proof. Under Camalthus, this is legal error, and this case should be remanded to apply the correct legal standard. The standards for CAT require the petitioner to demonstrate, is it more likely than not that he would be tortured if he was removed to his proposed country of removal. And credible testimony, if it's credible, may be sufficient to meet that burden of proof. However, the agency must also assess all the relevant evidence of possibility of torture, and if he was even tortured.
Counsel, so I want to tell you the three credibility areas that I'm most concerned about.
Okay.
I'm most concerned about his not remembering before the IJ that somebody put a gun to his head and told him he was going to die. I'm concerned about the medical report, which, even putting aside the questionable date, says he was there for 3 days, and he testified he was there for a week. And then the third, Dr. Kirkland's affidavit, which said that the guy was in hiding for 3 years, and your client's testimony, he wasn't in hiding. He was around. Everybody knew where he was. So those are the three that I'm most concerned about, credibility-wise.
Right. Okay. And in regards to the first one, the reason for him, I'm sorry, Judge, a little nervous. Can you repeat the first one again?
Sure. In his credible fear interview, he specifically said, knife, gun, they put a gun to my head and said, you're going to die.
Correct.
And in front of the IJ, on several testimony opportunities, he said knife, but he didn't remember whether it was a gun. The agency found that important and seems reasonable to me that somebody, if they were supposedly threatened with a gun, put it in next to their head, said they're going to die, that they would remember that.
Correct, Judge. So I'm just going to make it real easy. I'm going to concede that this was an inconsistency, right?
Okay, let's say you do that. Isn't the standard that you have the burden of proof?
Correct.
And the agency looks at the totality of the evidence. My colleague has pointed out three, at least from our perspective, very significant things that your client did or said that seem incredible. Isn't that enough to substantiate what the agency did here?
Even if he was found incredible, so even if there's substantial support to find a negative credibility determination, the problem here is that the agency, the immigration judge's decision, or the Board of Immigration Appeals just washed over his CAT claim. All they looked at
is... Wait a minute, that's a separate issue. Okay.
That is a separate issue, but I mean, it's important to know. I agree. I would concede that with the border, he did say that there was a gun and a knife, and when he testified,
so you're saying then you do
on that one that particular issue, I would say yes. I agree that there was an inconsistent statement.
You concede that your client was not credible. Is that correct?
On that particular issue, in terms of the medical record, he did say that he was in the hospital. The medical record said he was in the hospital for 3 days, and then he testified that he was in there for a week. He said he was getting treated for the stab wound on his right hand, and then he remained in the hospital because he was scared for trauma. That's what he said. It's not that inconsistent. I mean, a few days to a week.
Counsel, medical records sworn to under oath, and there was no evidence offered that they keep medical records differently in Guatemala. It said he was in the hospital 3 days. He said he was in the hospital 7 days. Whatever he was there for, this certificate is contrary because it said he was discharged in 3 days, right?
Yes, Judge, but it was just a couple days difference. And I think under the trauma, there is some case law that says that when you've suffered a traumatic event, such as an attempted rape, that a couple days.
That's for the trier to assess. I mean, the standard is whether or not any fact finder would be compelled to conclude that it was wrong. If it's a judgment call, then the agency's judgment has to stand. And if they're weighing 3 and 7, we can't really overturn that, can we?
No, Judge, I agree. I mean, I agree that the credibility determination, the adverse credibility determination, is a little bit more difficult to defend. But I still think that even despite that, the agency didn't do its duty in adjudicating the CAT claim.
I'm not sure that that's correct, because it walks through all the various conflicts in the testimony, and then it has a concluding paragraph: based on the inconsistencies cited by the immigration judge, we discern no clear error in the adverse credibility finding. So it's finished with credibility. But then it goes on and says, finally, we note the respondent also testified that other similarly situated family members, which include his mother, father, brother, and sister, remain unharmed in Guatemala. So that has nothing to do with credibility. Now the agency is saying, even apart from credibility, they're pointing to facts that suggest that the likelihood of future harm is not that great because, look, the family members are there and nothing is happening to them. So that seems to me like the agency is going on and saying beyond the – once we set aside the non-credible testimony, has he carried the burden? And the answer is no. Why am I wrong in reading it that
well,
way?
Well, it's a judge, I disagree, because that citation is to matter of AEM, and that board decision is only related to an asylum claim, and that's the problem, is that they didn't go through the CAT standard. They normally, in an asylum claim or withholding claim, you look to see first, is he credible? If he's not credible, it's over, and that's what they did here.
No, that's not true for asylum either. There are cases where someone can be found to be credible, not be credible, but nonetheless, other evidence would suggest that they do, in fact, present a danger. It's not common, and we've said that you have to look at whether the other evidence. But the inquiry is similar in terms of assessing likelihood of future harms and the fact that other people who were similarly situated to you are not confronting harm suggests maybe you're not going to, it's not more likely than not you'll face torture.
But the agency decision doesn't mention any of the other documents as it relates to.
Do we have any rule that says that we should reverse an agency decision because of a failure to mention a specific document if the agency says what Judge Collins quoted, and then at the end, as the in the BIA, as the respondent did not meet his burden of proof overall, we agree with the immigration judge's decision to deny the CAT request. Is there any case that says the failure to specifically, say, call out the country report is fatal in a case where somebody's found not credible, they found they don't meet their burden of proof overall, and the agency says family members have lived there without any torture or harm?
Well, the regulations require that the agency review all evidence of torture, so they have to review all the evidence. They didn't look at the country condition
report. But my question was, is there a case that says we need to grant the petition because the agency failed to mention particular evidence in its decision?
Yes, Judge. I think Cole would support that finding in Aguilar-Ramos versus Holder. There, the IJ or the BIA did not consider the country condition report, and that was a reason to remand the case.
But that was a situation where it didn't consider it. What my colleague has pointed out here is that many times a petitioner will bring a series of documents or other evidence, and he's asking, as indeed are we all, is there any case that says that considering a CAT claim that the IJ, or in this case the BIA, has to mention each and every one of the documents or arguments presented. There is no such case, is there?
There's no such case that mentions, but they have to consider all the documents, and they didn't consider the documents.
Don't you have to show they didn't consider it?
He didn't. They don't mention it in the IJ decision or the agency.
You're kind of going around in circles. Yeah, either they have to mention it, and there's no case that says they do, or they don't have to. It appears here that they said, you know, considering all the evidence, we ruled against your petitioner here. But they don't have to name them all.
Right, but they can't rely
solely. Name them all.
Judge, but they can't rely solely on the adverse credibility determination. Can I reserve the 1 minute I have?
Oh, yes, you can. Well, you don't have a minute, but you can reserve what you got.
Okay, thank you, Judge.
Very well, Mr. Eubanks, please.
Thank you, Your Honors. May it please the Court. Zachary Eubanks for the respondent, the United States Attorney General. The petition for review should be denied. Nothing in the record compels reversal of the agency's adverse credibility finding, and consequently, Nothing in the record compels reversal of the agency's ultimate determination to deny petitioner's request for torture convention protection. Here, the agency properly relied on the Real ID Act standard, specifically petitioner's inconsistent testimony regarding the key, regarding the timing and the chronology of the key events that led him to leave Guatemala in the first instance, his non-responsive testimony to basic cross-examination, as well as inconsistency between his testimony and the evidence he submitted to support and bolster his claim. Looking through the inconsistencies, when petitioners asked simply when he left Guatemala, he provided three different answers. He starts by saying October, changes it to August. Eventually, he said September, which I believe is the timeline he settled on for this court. Likewise, petitioner testifies that he was attacked by police officers and that he was stabbed in August of 2016. And this is what he told the asylum officer within about 6 weeks of entering the United States. However, when he's confronted with his own evidence suggesting that he would have been attacked in September, he immediately backtracks and tries to backfill his testimony.
But didn't he offer, we've had cases that say just mixing up dates can be a trivial inconsistency, right?
There are certainly cases that say that.
And the petitioner offered what seemed to me at least a credible-ish explanation that when he sorted it out all in his head, he can tie it all back to the final day. I think he said it was a Sunday for passing his exams. And when he's rethinking about it, tying the events to finally being done with school, that's how he came up with the final timeline he gave. Isn't that an explanation which should lead us to move on to other types of inconsistencies?
I can certainly move on, but I think that is the type of explanation that it goes to the fact finder in this first instance to decide whether or not that does explain the apparent discrepancy in the record. And looking at what the agency decision here, it is evaluated in the totality of the circumstances. This wasn't a silver bullet, just because petitioner mixed up these dates initially, that's why we're going to find him not credible. It matters for the totality of the circumstances and whether or not that explanation carries water.
So under our case law, if you have 5 points of evidence, 2 of them are kind of weak, but 3 are, the agency finds them significant. Under the totality of the evidence circumstances, we shouldn't be bothered by the fact that some of the inconsistencies are rather minor. But as long as there is substantial evidence as to, in this case, like the gun to the head concept, that's enough under the totality of the circumstances. Is that correct?
That is correct, specifically in this case, Your Honor. Again, looking at totality of circumstances, this court may choose to say, this court's role is not to look through each inconsistency one by one and nitpick and decide whether each inconsistency would support the adverse credibility finding. It's examining in the totality of the circumstances. So it's not a requirement that the agency bat 1,000 here. Petitioner has to show that the record compels that the agency's conclusion was flawed and that it should be reversed on these credibility grounds. Perhaps the most striking other than the gun to the head example is petitioner initially testifies that he was first attacked by the police officers and that's where he was stabbed. And then he testifies again that the next attack occurred the following Sunday and involved Edwin in the car. However, later he states that after he was stabbed, the only interaction he had with Edwin was a simple phone call. And when confronted with this inconsistency, petitioner simply denied making his previous testimony, and then he denied ever being asked for the order of the attacks in the first instance. Moreover,
is that conflict you just referenced, is that in the BIA decision or just in the IJ decision?
It's principally just in the immigration judge's decision. I would just note the way the board treated the immigration judge's decision. They didn't disavow any of the immigration
judges. They said, for example, right?
Yes. The government's position is this should be read as one agency decision. The immigration judge's decision is informing the board's decision, and it should be read as one agency decision because the board didn't disavow.
You don't view this as a case where the board narrowed down only these ones and not the ones we're not mentioning, because they sometimes do that.
Right, Your Honor, that's what I'm trying to differentiate. It's not a case where the board said, okay, this immigration judge's finding was clearly erroneous, but we're going to uphold anyway. Here, the board upheld the entirety of the immigration judge's decision and then just listed out certain examples that it thought were important in its review without disavowing or rejecting any of the immigration judge's reasoning. I do just want to address petitioner's general claim about the torture convention more broadly, if this court has no further questions on credibility. Here, without petitioner's credibility, there's simply no other claim that would compel reversal. Looking at Kamalthus, the issue in Kamalthus was, although the agency properly discounted that individual's testimony, there was this independent torture convention claim based off significant evidence of torture of Tamil males in Sri Lanka, and petitioner was a Tamil male. Here, petitioner doesn't point to any specific evidence aside from the testimony, which the agency reasonably found was incredible, to compel a finding that it's more likely than not that he will be tortured by or with the consent or acquiescence.
Am I remembering this right? Sorry, his uncle was murdered?
His uncle was murdered. We have the death certificate. We have the uncle's daughter wrote an affidavit. And
right.
We have,
so that's certainly not nothing, right?
It's not anything that would compel reversal, Your Honor. It's something that petitioner's family member was murdered. We have his daughter's statement suggesting that he was murdered, presumably involving with some racketeering or drug dealing in Guatemala. But that's realistically all we have that would, it doesn't necessarily tie into, again, that petitioner can meet his overall burden to show that he will more likely than not be tortured by or with the consent or acquiescence of a public official. Having an uncle murdered, it doesn't cross that threshold, Your Honor.
I mean, it sounds like, though, your friend's point is the agency didn't specifically talk about all this evidence that we submitted aside from credibility. And as a hypothetical, which isn't the case here, if the agency had said, we only looked at credibility, he's not credible, therefore under the law he can't get cat relief, that would be problematic, right?
Well, Your Honor, to use your specific phrasing, if they said as a matter of law, that would certainly be problematic, yes, Your Honor. And then again, it would just very much depend on each individual case will be different with what evidence is submitted. Because again, just looking at this case, we have Guatemalan country reports, and then several pieces of evidence that in significant ways contradict his own testimony. He wants to rely on this medical report. As Your Honor's noted, it differs with his own testimony on how long he was treated. His extra report, his testimony contradicts his expert report on whether or not Edwin fled or hid after the arrest warrant was issued. And moreover, the expert report states that these instances predicating petitioner's claim happened in 2014 or 2015, completely wrong years. And the expert report doesn't even mention that petitioner was stabbed. As a last point on the evidence, looking at, for instance, the affidavits, they all appear to be from third hand based off petitioner's own statements. Again, it all loops back into what he has said other than the arrest warrant and the death certificate for the uncle. That's basically the objective evidence in this case, and it does not compel finding that petitioner will more likely than not be tortured by or with the consent or acquiescence of a public official, Your Honors. If there's no further questions, the government will simply state.
I think not.
Thank you, Your Honors. The government will request that the petition for review be denied for the reasons stated here and in our brief. Thank you, Your Honors.
Very well. Thank you. Ms. Esparza, you've got a little bit of time left.
Thank you, Judge. Yes, I would just like to repeat that even if it is found that petitioner was not credible, an adverse credibility determination does not by itself defeat a CAT claim. And here the agency did not address the CAT claim the way it was supposed to by addressing all of the evidence, the country conditions, even decide or make a finding if he was tortured. They didn't even address that issue. They just relied on his negative credibility determination, said he hasn't met his burden.
Well, you've said that several times. The record seems to indicate to the contrary. Do you have anything you want to bring to our attention other than the credibility issue that you claim was the sum and substance of the BIA's decision on CAT?
Yes, Judge. The comment that the government indicated that there was no objective statements, this is also incorrect because there is a statement by the respondent's cousin, and that was an eyewitness account of her seeing her father be killed, and there's also a sworn arrest warrant. That's also, there was no dispute about whether it was legitimate or not legitimate. So there are other independent documents in the record that show that the court, the agency, the immigration judge, or the BIA did not review.
Your time is up. Let me ask my colleagues whether either has additional questions. I think not. Thank you very much, Ms. Esparza. The case just argued, Fuentes versus Garland, is submitted.